And I just want to say one thing. Happy Valentine's Day.
Every day the 14th.
I don't think y'all heard me. I just want to say happy Valentine's Day.
Hello again, everybody, and welcome to Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I am the director of the Geo-Institute. That is why we call the show Director's Cut. As you can see from the decorations behind me, or maybe you cannot tell, this is our very special Valentine's Day episode. Love is in the air. Love is on Director's Cut. Joining us this week, my guest from Haley and Aldrich, in Boston, Massachusetts, Damian Siebert.
You need to work on your Boston accent a little
bit. Yeah, I don't have one.
That's all right.
I definitely don't have one. If you like what you see today, and I think you will, click on the little button outside the window that you're watching this in that says subscribe. Then you can click on that little bell on your screen that says get notifications. You will be notified every single time we post a video to our YouTube channel, which is frequently. Damian, are you ready for your time to shine?
Bring it on. I feel like it's kind of like this game show where I need a buzzer in front of me while you ask the question. I gotta, you know, real quickly be like, all right, 42, meaning of life.
Yeah. I can guarantee you that is not the answer to any of these questions.
All right.
We will start with you the same way we start with everyone else on Director's Cut. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
All right, so are you going to pull out a stopwatch? So this is my elevator speech, right? You know, you get on the elevator and you got to tell this quick story. So I break my job into two different categories. The external facing portion of it, which I love, and then the internal facing portion, which I also love. So externally, I like to think that I help my clients sleep better at night, right? You know, doing whatever it is that I can do. They come to me with these cool challenges, and I try and help them solve them. You know, oftentimes I get to use my geotechnical and structural engineering skills on this, but even more so, it's just, they want me to help them navigate the risks, you know, understand the pros and cons of what they're doing and come up with a solution that's the quote unquote best solution, you know, for them, understanding and balancing all these different things. And then the internal portion, which, you know, I have the joy of working for a company that I really, really like, and they give me a lot of opportunities. And so part of my job internally is to basically make sure I've got the right people in the right seats, giving them the right tools with the right skills to serve our clients. And it's really cool. It's really enjoyable. So I don't mind coming to work, which in this case is just, you know, coming from my bedroom downstairs to my office, which is also the workout room and the pass through to every other part of the house. But
it can be an arduous walk, though. I mean, you never know what's going to happen on the way.
It's true. It's very true.
So before you make that walk, that is our next question. What time is your alarm set to every morning, and what time do you actually get out of bed?
All right. Well, this has to go back to, we got to divide this up too into pre-COVID and COVID, right? Because it's become very, very different. So pre-COVID, I had the alarm set for 5:30 every morning. And this was typically before the light comes up, before the sun comes shining in, and my wife's asleep, my kids are asleep. And so I was trained that the second that alarm went off, I had to turn it off and get out of bed as quietly as I possibly could. Everything was packed up the night before so I could sneak out and not wake anybody up. So then COVID hit, and I was no longer going into the office, and I was no longer going to the gym first thing in the morning. So now I don't even set an alarm. I'll be totally honest. It's, I get up at whatever it is, between 6:30 and 7, can roll out of bed, come downstairs in my pajamas, sit in front of the computer. So, you know, we talk about all these awful, awful things to occur out of COVID, but this is actually one benefit for me, is that I'm getting more sleep now, to be honest, than I've ever gotten. Used to be 5:30, it's no longer, and I have to admit, I don't really miss that. I don't really miss that, because those mornings where I would actually accidentally wake up a family member, oh man, I'd hear that for the rest of the week. So good.
Both of those times though are impressive to me, because I'm a 7:37 or like 7:43 kind of guy, and the alarm is set for 7 o'clock. So that was the genesis of that question. I'm like, everybody must be just like me and have a hard time getting up.
Yeah. No, I'm definitely more of that morning person. I'm ready for it. Bring it on, man. Bring it on.
So we go right into the questions about, I guess, your professional life. What is the oldest foundation you have ever worked on?
All right. So as you said at the top of the interview, I am from Boston now. Lived here now longer than I've lived anywhere else, and it's a pretty old part of the United States, right? So I mean, we're not talking Roman Colosseum old or ancient Mayan civilization old, but still, I've got to work on some pretty cool old stuff. But I'll take it in a slightly different bent or a little bit different twist, and I'll tell you the coolest old thing we've ever found, or I've ever found in an excavation. So we do, you know, dig a lot of big holes in the ground, and in the fill, you pull up all sorts of old bottles and plates and stuff that are pretty cool. But if anybody who's familiar with Boston, there's the Seaport District that you can actually see when you're flying into Logan. And over the last 15 years or so, it's really started to develop. It used to be parking lots and warehouses, and it's really started to become this vibrant part of the community. And so we were working fairly recently on this 7-story office building. Was going to be a 17-story office building, and digging a big hole in the ground for that, slurry wall around the outside, and we're digging down and we're digging through the fill, and Boston's got a lot of history where we filled in a lot of land. We needed more land, so we filled it in, a whole bunch of fill. And we're getting to the bottom of the fill, and we're starting to get some wood. The excavator, the earthwork contractor's pulling out some of these wood, starts to excavate a little bit more. Turns out we found a 50-foot long 19th century old lime schooner that had basically, it was in that time, you know, late or 1900s, 1870s or so, from Rockport, Maine, they would bring down all these boats within these lime barrels. And we know it's lime because we dug up an old lime barrel that said, you know, Rockport Lime Company. And lime can be pretty reactive. So it's probably something caught fire while they were waiting in the harbor. Ship burned, the back of it was all burnt, you could still see it charred, sunk to the bottom. And you know, rather than trying to salvage it or pull it out, when they started to fill in all that area of Boston, they ended up just filling right on top of the boat. And so, you know, it's pretty cool. So we actually called, or the contractor at the time called the Boston Archaeological Society, and they came down and actually managed to take large sections of the boat out. And they found some plates and forks on the boat that they could date very specifically, that they hadn't been made until 1869. And we know that the Boston Harbor in that area was filled in 1886. So, you know, they could date, even though there was no record of this ship fire, they could date exactly, almost exactly when it happened. And it was just pretty cool to be standing at the top of this big hole, looking down at the excavation and seeing this giant ship. I mean, you can Google, Google ship found in Boston excavation, and you'll see these pictures of it. It's really neat. You know, it's kind of
so. Where did you follow what happened to the pieces of the ship and the artifacts that were found? Do you know where they are today?
Yeah, you can actually the Boston Archaeological Society has a GoFundMe page page, and they're trying to raise some money so that they can continue to preserve it. And so they have big chunks of it, and they actually have a website that you can go to, and it talks all about it. So it's pretty interesting.
Well, that is very cool. So you are an adjunct faculty member at Tufts, I believe, is it not?
I was, yep.
What was the hardest part about being an adjunct faculty member, or the challenges from all different parts of your life, or walking in and seeing these students. And I don't know, it was always a little different when you had an adjunct. What was the hardest thing for you?
Yeah. So I had this very idealistic view of, you know, what being an adjunct professor was, maybe. And so I think I was a bit naive, to be honest. I figured that I would walk into the classroom and I'd be able to just, you know, enrich these young minds with knowledge, put together a few tests, grade some homework, leave at the end of the day feeling like I have just made this huge impact on these kids' lives. And that was like my dream going in, I guess, and this vision that I had out of it. And very quickly, I came to realize that, my gosh, there is an incredible amount of drama in college. I mean, I felt like I was on, you know, like the Real Students of Tufts University, you know, some reality TV show, because every day I'd walk in or at the end of the class and, you know, we had like the drama of plagiarism, which, you know, was this very serious thing. And I was like, you got to be kidding me. We're in college. You know, I had a grad student that wouldn't do any work and didn't understand why he was failing. I mean, it's, you know, shocking stuff, right? You got like kids sleeping through class. And, you know, that may have been more of a reflection on my teaching ability than the students, but we'll leave that on the side. Crying. There was crying at the end of some class, you know, classes, people coming up because they didn't like the grade they got. You know, I just think of what's the baseball movie with, you know, League of Their Own, right? You know, I felt like, you know, there's no crying in engineering. Come on. Talking about. But no, I mean, in all seriousness, it was very rewarding, and it was a great experience, and I did enjoy it very much despite all that drama. You know, I mean, I've got two kids at home myself, you know, teenagers, and now one of them teenager now, and I just kept thinking, I don't need this drama. I get enough of that at home. This isn't supposed to be part of that. So
do any of your students keep in touch with you?
Yeah, I've hired some of them. So that was, you know, that was this huge benefit that I got out of being an adjunct, right? I'd be like, you're the best student. I want you to come work with me. I'm totally poaching you. And so, yeah, so they do. And I'll get, you know, random emails from some. And it's really nice. You know, it's really nice. I can see the allure to being a professor and having that, you know, pipeline of young, fresh minds that it's pretty invigorating, actually. You know,
what percent of the time do you not remember the student who contacts you?
Oh my god, that's I'm sad to say it's a pretty high frequency, and again, that's just on me, man. I can't, I've got to like repeat someone's name 50 times before I can remember. I couldn't remember A League of Their Own, right? When we were just talking, it's this memory thing. And the older I get, the worse it gets, which is just depressing.
Do you ever go with the send me a photo? I've had a couple of those. A professor will come to a university, somebody that I had an undergrad or something, will move to a university in the DC area, and I'll say, hey, I saw that you're in the area, congratulations or whatever, and I'll get the, can you send me a picture? I don't remember who you are.
That's really, well, see, no, that's the beauty of Google and the internet, right? I have no shame in stalking. So I'll get the email and I'll be like, all right, I got to Google this LinkedIn or images and it's incredible. I mean, it's so scary at the same time, but I don't need to do any of that stuff. It's all there on the internet, all posted. So, so you know, with the moral of that story, careful what you post or you have out there.
So the other question that we ask everybody on this show is, how did you originally get involved with ASCE and GI?
Yeah. So I love these. I love when I watch the director's cut, and I love that question and hearing.
Are you gonna make up an exciting story, or is this 100% true?
Totally gonna make up an exciting story, and all those people that were with me, they'll back me up absolutely. No, so it actually for me started in college. it absolutely did. I you know, came in as this young buck wanting to figure out what I wanted to do with my life. I knew I wanted to be an engineer, but didn't know what kind of engineer I wanted to be. And so I got involved with the concrete canoe and the steel bridge. That was a competition. I went to Tufts, that was a competition, the two competitions that they participated in. And it was so much fun because of the camaraderie, because of the people that I was doing it with. The faculty advisor that we had was just such a good person and just really wanted us to enjoy what it is that we were doing, and would bring in people in the industry to help us. You know, well, why don't you think about things this way? Or here's how I might do that. And, you know, I loved the long nights in the lab. Like, literally, we had a, you know, now it'd be a health and safety nightmare, right? We had this lab in the basement that we would go down at like 10 o'clock at night and turn on the lights, and there would be one or two of us in there. We'd be using band saws and, you know, giant drills and making the steel bridge or testing concrete cylinders with, you know, all sorts of lightweight stuff that we could come up with to put in it. And it was just a lot of fun. It was just a lot of fun. And it gave me this very meaningful connection to engineering and to ASCE, you know, at that point. I didn't really know the GI at that point even existed. It was really just ASCE, and just how passionate people are and want to give back to the society and to the profession. And it really made a strong impression on me. And it's something that I wanted to do. And so when I graduated from college and started working, I got involved, you know, at the local level with the Geo-Institute chapter in Boston, one of the oldest ones, and kind of worked my way up through that, and then had an opportunity to work with you and others on, you know, at a more national level at the local involvement committee. And now get to help out, you know, the members community. And it's rewarding for me, and I enjoy it. And I'll do it as long as I feel like I'm actually giving something back that people want to hear. once they're like, all right, you're too old at this point. That's okay. I'll let someone else have their way. But
so if you're watching this and you're in New England and you've thought to yourself, what's my Geo Institute chapter? You can reach out to Damian and he will guide you.
Absolutely. Without a doubt. Even in region one, I'll be able to steer you at this point, right? If you don't know what the regions are, go look at the map. It's another thing you can Google.
So we're halfway through here. We got some other fun ones. Well, they're all fun, really.
Yeah.
Let's be honest.
Absolutely.
I don't know how many geo-congresses you've been to. I would say it's got to be several at this point, right?
A lot.
What is your favorite geo-congress presentation that you have ever seen?
Yeah. So full disclosure, I got this question in advance, and I really had to think about it. And it's a great question, because I did. I started to go back and was like, man, I've been going to geo-congresses since, you know, 2010 or something, maybe even a little bit before that, 2005. So I've been seeing a lot of geo-congresses. And I actually even ended up pulling up some of the old ones to be like, oh, you know, what are some of those talks that I've been to? I started going through them all, and I was like, oh, that was a great one, and that was a great one. But what really, really more recently made an impression on me was the GeoPit talks in Philly, and just how inspirational some of them were and how interesting I found them. And, you know, I was thinking back through them, and I think it's absolutely unbelievable that you've posted those on the YouTube channel so that people can go and see them, because I think they really, a lot of them highlighted kind of how special of an industry and profession that we're working in, and how we can all continue to evolve and grow and embrace new technology, not only to help our own careers, but to help society and to the benefit of society. And they really were inspirational. And I mean, where else would in a profession allow, you know, Kevin Frankie to fly a drone inside and luckily not kill anybody, and talk about how you can use this technology to to literally transform the world and make it a better place. Or Menzer's talk on inclusion before it was this huge buzzword in the world. Mm-hmm. And, you know, or Cord Wissman's on the Star Wars analogy, which was just spot on, and geo transformation, and how, you know, we all talk about this world of commoditization that we're in, and really how to break out of that through innovation. And Scott Anderson, you know, highlighted that with his augmented reality. And I was just praying he wasn't going to walk off the stage with those glasses on.
He's a pro.
I know, it was very impressive. And just, I've gone back and watched some of those presentations on YouTube, and they're great, just really for inspiration. And so those by far, the technical stuff is fantastic, and I come back and I use that. But for me, that the Geo Institute gave those people the ability to showcase kind of what a special profession it is that we're working in. I just thought those were great. Absolutely.
I totally didn't ask you to do that plug for the YouTube channel, but there it was. That was fantastic. So for all you viewers out there, there are 21 Pit Talks available on the GI YouTube channel. You should go enjoy them. The other thing I would say about your response there is that flying the drone may have involved not telling the union guys about it at the Pennsylvania Convention Center. So, yeah, we figured the best way to go about it was just to do it and apologize later.
Ask for forgiveness later. I love that approach.
And we survived. It caused a little bit of a stir, but everybody was okay.
Yes. Yeah.
So we go from Geo-Congress to Geo-Congress has become one of my passions. I guess it has to be, because I'm paid for it to be one of my passions. But one of my other passions in life is ice cream. Damian, what is your least favorite ice cream flavor that you have ever tried in your life?
All right. Well, during the pandemic, another benefit of the pandemic, trying to look at things in the positive light, is that my daughter and I became obsessed with making ice cream. You know, we've got the Cuisinart ice cream maker that you put in the freezer and it churns it for you. And bought all these ice cream cookbooks to try all these new flavors. And so, you know, it got to a point, especially in the summer, where we were making 2 to 3 ice creams a week, like literally, no joke, 2 to 3 ice creams a week, and having no trouble finishing them at all, let me tell you. We made some great flavors. But there was this one flavor where one day we do this farm share, and we got in the farm share a whole bunch of beets. And yes, beet, the root vegetable, the red root vegetable, the beet. And there was this recipe for beet ice cream. And I was like, God, what could go wrong here? I love beets. I love ice cream. This is going to be a great combination. I just know it will. So we made the beet ice cream, and the color was just awesome. So intense and so red. And you put it in the freezer, and it was more of kind of maybe a sorbet-ish thing, you know, it had a higher water content. So it froze, and it froze solid, man. I mean, this wasn't like ice cream you get to dig into. This is more like ice crystals that you were chipping out. And well, needless to say, it was a little earthy and a little sweet at the same time. Tasted a bit like eating sugared dirt, maybe, with not the best aftertaste related to it. So it was a bit cloying. So at the end of the day, we took that out of our rotation. We no longer make beet ice cream.
Who consumed the majority of that one? Did it get consumed?
I have this aversion to letting anything go to waste. The human trash compactor in our house, you know, everything gets finished. And so I actually ended up finishing. It took much longer than that week, but I did end up finishing that beet ice cream.
I think the more years you get into daddom, the greater that instinct becomes that you must finish everything.
It's so true. I mean, at the end of meals, my kids just, they don't even ask me anymore. They're like, take their plates and just kind of slide them over in front of me. And I'm like, all right, here we go.
So we'll get one more engineering question before we finish up with two fun ones here. Since you are in Boston, we must ask a question about the Big Dig. And the one I want to ask is, what impact do you think the Big Dig had regionally and even nationally on perceptions of civil engineering and the industry in general?
Yeah, I mean, that's a multifaceted question to answer.
That's why it was in the director's cut list.
There we go. We could spend hours and hours talking about that. I'll give two different perspectives that I have on that. No more light, easy, breezy stuff like ice cream, right? I think it had.
We'll get back to that in a minute.
All right, good. Appreciate that. I think it had a very positive impact on some aspects, and I think it had a very negative impact on other aspects, or the perception in civil engineering. You know, on the positive side, right, it was one of the largest construction projects in the U.S. at the time, and it included just so many, you know, firsts in engineering and in geotechnical engineering, and the use of unbelievable new technologies on a very large scale, being incredibly innovative, you know, ground freezing. We took the elevated artery, you know, the green monster, they called it, the other green monster, not the Fenway Park wall. And we took it and we put it 100 feet underground. And all of a sudden opened up the city to this greenway now, and where people can enjoy it. There's not this big steel structure. It's absolutely amazing. And, you know, it kept a lot of, we got this iconic, right, Zakim Bridge and the Ted Williams Tunnel, all these things that are unbelievable feats of engineering. And it kept a lot of really good engineers and contractors employed for a long time doing amazing things. But then there's the negative aspect of it that a lot of people hear about and is in the news a lot, right, is that there were massive cost overruns, mm-hmm. that you have sections that are leaking. There was that horrible death when a ceiling tile fell off. And it's gotten a lot of negative publicity in that round. And you know, rightfully so for certain aspects of it. But for the engineers working on it, and it was an extremely challenging, extremely rewarding project that really helped to push forward then advance the profession. And so I think in the engineering community, it is looked on with some awe, and there's a lot of good things to be learned. And at the same time, I think there's a lot of bad things that we need to learn from as well with it. So, you know, both positives and negatives, which happens with a lot of things, right?
A great layered but still succinct answer. That was excellent. We've got two left. They're going to be fun. One right. is a simple one, I think. What was your favorite TV show as a kid?
Oh, man. So I grew up in New Mexico in the Southwest. And, you know, at the time we didn't have cable or anything like that. It was the TV with the bunny ears. And we didn't watch a lot of TV. There was just too much other stuff to do, I remember. But I do have these vivid memories of waking up on Saturday morning and sitting down and watching cartoons. And the ones I loved by far was the Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner show. And more specifically, you know, Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner. I mean, I grew up in New Mexico in the Southwest. And so I loved seeing the desert portrayed, you know, these mesas where they'd be running along and inevitably he'd fly off. Wile E. would fly off the end and, you know, plummet down. And you'd see the tumbleweeds rolling past. And I was like, hey, you know, I can relate to that. That actually happens outside my window. I loved it. And Chuck Jones, you know, his animation and ability to tell stories. I really liked them as a kid growing up. Absolutely.
So you weren't like a hipster hater? Like anytime there's a show on that's set in DC, I'm always like, you can't really get from Alexandria to Capitol Hill in 10 minutes.
Well, it was beauty. It was a cartoon. So it was, you know, it was all good. It was all good. But I'm with you on that.
So our final one is another New England question. What is the most underrated place to be outdoorsy in New England? I know you and are an outdoorsy guy. You will have an opinion on this question.
So I've got a very strong opinion on this. And I don't know, the term underrated is tough because I don't know how underrated these things are, but I'll start off really, really big. And I'm going to say the entire state of Maine. I love Maine, man. You want to be outdoors? Maine is the place to be. We spent a lot of time outdoors and try and spend a lot of time in Maine. And it's just absolutely amazing and very secluded. So I'll bring it down a little more narrow. There's the Appalachian Mountain Club. And they're an organization, and they have these little camps, all throughout New England. And they've got one in Maine called Metawisla. And Metawisla is a term for a loon. And it's set on Second Roach Lake in the heart of the 100-mile wilderness. So it's the middle of nowhere. There's no cell service. Incredible hiking, beautiful, pristine lakes that nobody is, in for hundreds of miles. Moose, whatever you want, it's there for you. And it's just, it's a very special place in general. And so, I don't know, I would highly recommend, if you like outdoor stuff, Maine is the place to be.
So is that right on the Appalachian Trail then? Because that club, the Mid-Atlantic equivalent, is the Potomac Appalachian Trail Club. And they have many similar facilities that were based on the ones that were built in New England. But I think ours are a little less remote.
Yeah, I mean, these are pretty rugged. They have different levels of camp. Like this one actually has running water and electricity, which is great. They have camps that don't have running water and electricity. They make it all on site and stuff like that. But it's actually at the very close to the foot of Katahdin, which depending upon either the start or the end of the Appalachian Trail, depending upon which way you go.
And the highest point in Maine.
Very true. Well done. Look at you with your
geography. A little bit of a geography nerd.
Love it. Love it.
So you survived, Damian. We have thus far a 100% survival rate on Director's Cut. We will hope that continues through 2021 and beyond. Thank you again for joining us and for being a good sport and answering all the questions as they were presented.
Not even
again,
answers, right?
Yes. If you enjoyed watching this today, and I hope you did. I think you did if you stuck around to the end. Click on that subscribe button. Click get notifications. We will let you know every single time that we post a video to YouTube. Happy Valentine's Day. Now a couple days late to everybody out there in viewer land. We hope you enjoyed the decorations and saw the light up necklace. That was the pièce de résistance here today, I believe. So thanks again, Damian. This was a lot of fun. And we will see everybody next week.